Welcome to Trial Site News Podcast Series. My name is Adrian, and today we have the pleasure to be speaking with Sharee Page about her fight with breast cancer and, in a strange twist of fate, a similar battle that her two other sisters are also fighting. So Sharee, thank you for joining us, and welcome.
Well, thanks. It's really exciting to be here. Thanks for having me.
It's our pleasure. Now, one of the things that struck me about your story is how positive you are, especially considering that you have had other family members diagnosed with different kinds of cancer. It's hard enough when you are diagnosed, but having loved ones diagnosed as well, I can imagine, would be difficult. And it looks like you and your family members have found comfort in one another and have been able to fight cancer together.
Yeah. Honestly, I think that's what helped me stay positive. As my mom's a two-time cancer survivor.
Oh, wow.
My grandma died of breast cancer, but my uncle's had cancer. I mean, I feel like cancer is just always in the cards for me, which sounds terrible, but I think that was actually beneficial. So when I got cancer, it really wasn't that scary because I'd seen people get cancer and get through it.
That makes a lot of sense. Now, before we dive into questions about your cancer and the journey that you've been on, I'd like our audience to get to know a little more about you. I've heard that you love to travel, and that, as you put it, that you've done more in your 34 years than most do in their entire lives.
Yeah, I feel very fortunate. I've spent the last 16 years traveling the world. I've been to over 75 countries, and my goal is to at least hit 100 before I die, so cancer can't take me yet because I got at least 25 more countries to go to. But I feel like the adventures and the experiences, I've taught English in China. I lived in China.
Oh, wow.
When I was 19 and taught English. I just have so many amazing opportunities and experiences in life. And I feel like that's what life is all about, is experiencing and learning and growing from those experiences. And so I feel very blessed with the life I've had. So,
well, that's amazing. So you've been to 74 countries so far?
Over 75. I just actually got back last week from Croatia, Bosnia, Montenegro, and Slovenia.
Oh, wow.
So I added four more a week ago.
That's amazing. What's your favorite place you visited so far?
Oh my gosh, I always quote the Ever After line. I no sooner choose a favorite star in the heavens, which I know is so cheesy that I know that line, but I can't. It's so hard to choose a favorite. Like, they're all so amazing and unique, just like human beings, like in their own individual way. But mm-hmm. I will always have a tender spot in my heart for China because I've lived there. However, like, Ireland is so green, Africa, the people, the animals, like going on a safari was probably one of the coolest things I've ever done. I mean, I could go on and on about every country. I love them all.
Well, that's amazing. Well, I hope you get to all of the countries.
Oh, you know I will. Oh, all the countries, 165. I was thinking I'll get to my 100 goal.
Well, you're almost there. Might as well go all the way.
I know, right? Why give up now? Thanks for that. You know what? That's the motivation I needed. I'm going to all of them, dang it.
That's how it's done. Now, let's bring it back in. And the first question I'm going to ask you today is, how did you realize that you might have cancer? How did that come about?
All right. Well, it's actually kind of crazy. So my brother's wife, she was only 38 or 39 at the time. She was diagnosed with a rare angiosarcoma in February of 2016. And anyhow, 2 months later, my sister, who's also the one I travel the world with, one of my best friends, we do everything together. She had like a huge, like, grapefruit sized lump in her left breast. And she finally went and got it checked, and it was stage 3C breast cancer. And so in the meantime, within a week, I'm like filling my own, and I'm like, should I be nervous? I have a lump too. But mine was like maybe the size of a nickel or a dime. Mm. And of course, everyone's like, yes, you need to go get that checked. So I hurried and went into her same doctor. And within 3 days, I was diagnosed with breast cancer as well. So within 2 weeks, my sister and I were diagnosed with breast cancer at the same time.
Wow.
And so honestly, I mean, you hate to call it a blessing that your sister had cancer, but I don't think I would have caught mine so early had she not been diagnosed with her cancer. But it was a blessing because then we went through treatments together, and we did chemo together. We shaved our heads together. We did our double mastectomies. Like, we just kind of did everything together. It was kind of unique and a cool experience. And you know, not many people are going to go through cancer with their sister.
No. Well, and on that note, how was your initial feeling at being diagnosed? I mean, your sister had just gotten diagnosed, and then you go in there, and how was
that? Well, I think you're going to, like, think I'm crazy. I think the doctor thought I was crazy. Like, my initial response was, like, laughter, because I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. I'm like, am I in the Twilight Zone? Like, there is no way that my brother's wife has cancer, my sister has cancer, and I have cancer. Like, no, like, God wouldn't do that. Like, no way. You know, like, so when he, like, they immediately could tell when they did my mammogram and ultrasound, it was like right at the same day. in time. And she's like, the nurse looked really like uncomfortable. She's like, one moment. She's like, went and got the doctor, and he came in and he just looked like he was about to cry, like a sweet man. And yeah. I said, he's like, we saw something that we want to do a biopsy on. I'm like, why? I think it's cancer. And I just said it very like just like how I just said it. And like I said, he looked like he was going to cry. And he's like, yeah, we're pretty confident it's cancer. We've seen this a million times. Obviously we can't say for sure until we get the biopsy, but we're pretty sure this is cancer. So they basically told me on the spot that I had cancer even without biopsying it. But then they did a biopsy that same day. But I was so calm. I was just like kind of chuckling a little bit. I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. And they're like, you understand like the repercussions of cancer? I'm like, yeah, I understand. I'm just saying like everyone in my family has cancer right now. So this is actually kind of comical. So weird response, I know, but if I'm being honest with you, that was just my initial like shocked and like, this is humorous.
Well, yeah. What were the odds?
Yeah, that's why it's so humorous. Like you're like, okay, like that is uncanny. I don't even know what to say. So I was definitely shocked because I did not plan on hearing that I had cancer, especially at age 34. And that my sister just was diagnosed. I'm like, yeah, right. But yeah, that's pretty crazy.
No, and I know what you mean, especially at, because I'm the same age as you, and you know, we tend to feel like we're invulnerable and, you know, gonna live forever and kind of a thing. And
oh, absolutely. No. I still feel that way.
So because you saw, you know, an array of your family members coming down with cancer, like one after another, did you have genetic testing done to find out if you carry a gene specific to cancer?
Absolutely. Immediately when the doctors have someone, especially that young, these girls getting breast cancer at such a young age, they wanted to do the genetic testing immediately. So my sister was the first one to have the genetic testing done. I was like a week later. And we, of course, came back with the BRCA. BRCA2 gene is what I call it, or the BRCA2 gene, which, you know, ends up giving you an 85% chance of getting breast cancer, ovarian cancer, a higher percentage, and all other kinds of cancers. So.
Oh, wow.
And then they wanted to test the rest of my family. So I have 5 siblings. And so my brother went in and got tested. 2 other sisters went and got tested. I have 1 sister who was positive, another sister that's negative. And then I have 1 brother who just has decided not to be tested.
You'd rather just go through it, not know.
Yeah.
So after your diagnosis, you decided to share your journey with the world by recording videos about your experiences. You obviously have quite a sense of humor about the situation. How did you manage to keep the positive, upbeat view?
Well, you know, I get asked that question a lot. And I always have tried to like figure out the answer to that because I'm like, what was it? What was that key ingredient? And I'll be honest, like straight up, I was born a cheerful person. You know how like we all have a certain disposition? I've always been pretty bubbly, cheerful, like that's probably how people would describe me. Yeah. So a lot of that was my nature, but I also believe that in life, we kind of see and get what we focus on. And I've always tried, I'm not always successful, but I've always tried to focus on the positive. And so I found that the more I look at the things that I have that I'm grateful for in my life, it's a lot harder to be upset or unhappy or negative, you know? Especially I think it helps that I've traveled and seen people truly in destitute situations. And I recognize that, yeah, it does suck. Like, don't get me wrong. No one wants to have cancer. It was awful. But there are a lot of really horrible things that people go through, have been through. I mean, we've all sat in history class. We've heard about what happened during the Holocaust and other horrible wars and atrocities. I mean, so can I really sit and cry myself to sleep every night because I have a, you know, genetic disorder that, yeah, caused me to get breast cancer. And yeah, I have to go through some hard things, but doesn't everybody go through something hard?
That's fair.
And so I think that's kind of what helped me. I don't know if that's a good answer, but it's just my honest, I think, recognizing that you have a lot of things to be grateful for. So.
Well, that's, and it's amazing viewpoint because it is easy to, you know, our outlook on life stems from where we were born and our initial experiences. And so it's easy to feel like everything is on you, but that's still because it's a big deal and it's life altering. And so to keep that positive, upbeat view and outlook, you know, that's incredible.
Well, thanks. And it's not like I always like want people to know, like, it's not like it's every single moment. Of course you have moments of being like, dude, this blows. Like, I can't believe that I have to, you know, you have those times, but it's the ability to maybe look out and go, okay, I'm not the only person in the world suffering right now. And so recognizing that resistance is suffering. So if the more I resist what I'm currently going through, the worse it's going to be. So
right.
Allow and try to make the best of every situation you have. I think you'll find the life's a lot better, not just when it comes to cancer, but you could apply that to any aspect of life.
No, it's true. I mean, it's how I've always lived my life, which is, you know, taking everything that I've gone through and say, okay, you know, I wouldn't be the person I was today if I didn't go through that positive or negative experience.
Absolutely, 100%. And I've had other things like growing up in my life, like not to step in because I know it's not a topic about those things, but I mean, I had a rare bone disorder in my jaw when I was a kid, and I always knew I would have to have jaw surgery when I was older. So I had an underbite growing up, and I mean, that was hard. You know, I wanted to look a certain way and I didn't. And I think I found solace in just knowing, like, looking back, I said that was one of the biggest blessings because I know what it's like to feel different. I know what it's like, you know, and so it's like going through hard things is what made me the strong, whatever qualities I really like about myself today. It was because of the hard things I went through. So, yeah.
Awesome. Well, we love you sharing it. And so, speaking of sharing, how has sharing your journey affected your experience with cancer?
Oh, my goodness. This is another thing that I think people are going to laugh, but I honestly look back at my experience with cancer, and sharing my journey was probably the best thing I could have done because it helped me not only to like get it off my chest, how I was thinking and how I was feeling, but it gave me a purpose through the cancer journey. And then it also helped me to take the focus off myself as I had people from all over the world reaching out to me, like telling me their stories of like, hey, I was just diagnosed and I'm struggling with this. And it helped me stop focusing so much on my pain, my suffering, my frustration, because I was connecting with other people who are also suffering. And I really believe that connection is what keeps us as human beings, like feeling alive and really what makes us happy. And so it brought me so much happiness and joy knowing that sharing my story was helping other people. And then it also in turn just created an overwhelming sense of love and compassion I felt from my fellow human beings and like mankind. I realized, I mean, I think I already knew this, but it solidified how I feel about my fellow human beings. Like, people are so good. And I think we have a like hard time nowadays when we watch the news or we get on social media, we see people as like the other or our enemy. And going through cancer helped me realize like people are kind. People are compassionate. People are good. Because people treated me amazing the entire time that I was going through chemotherapy. And a lot of it was, I think, because I had a bald head. And I have a video that I did one time because I noticed that I was always being treated really well because people could see that I was sick because I had a bald head and I didn't look super healthy, you know? But I was thinking about people who suffer inside. You know, what about this person who suffers from severe anxiety or depression or, you know, has problems at home or at their job? You know, you never know what people are going through. I mean, everyone's facing a battle, right?
Right.
And I thought, what if we treated everybody like they had a bald head? What kind of world would we live in? You know? And so it's just a very eye-opening, wonderful experience. So I can look back on my cancer journey and say, I am so glad I shared it with the world because it showed me the humanity and the love and the compassion that still exists out there.
You're right. And that's wonderful to know that that was your experience there. So what advice then would you give to someone who was just recently diagnosed with cancer?
I would say try to, once again, I'm going to quote my favorite, one of my favorites, Eckhart Tolle. He says, accept the present moment as if you had chosen it, you know, all else is madness, you know, and I'm not quoting him exactly, but I would say, okay, like say, okay, I have cancer. I'm going to experience what it's like to have cancer. And for good or for bad, it's going to give me growth, experience, insights, perspective that I would have never had any other way. So take that and try to make the most of it and be easy on yourself. Don't be so hard on yourself. Know that you're going to have days that are hard. You're going to have days where you feel like, I don't know why I got this. I can't do this. I'm not strong enough, but don't be so hard on yourself and trust that there is going to be a purpose behind this. And I don't mean some divine purpose per se. I'm not saying I don't mean that, but I'm not saying that, but I know, and I believe that things work together for your good eventually. And the most horrific thing can usually, and sometimes typically, turn out to be a blessing later when you can look back and see the growth and the change and the strength you gained from going through something hard. So maybe try to focus on that.
Makes sense. Now, on a side note, where are you now in your journey with cancer?
Well, currently I'm in remission. They don't declare you cancer free for 5 years. So I am in remission. I actually had a little bit of a scare past couple months. So I had a PET scan a couple weeks ago and they found something on my thyroid, just like a little nodule that they wanted to test. So I had a biopsy 2 weeks ago and it came back inconclusive. They can't rule out cancer, but they also couldn't declare it's cancer. So at the end of the month, I have an appointment with a specialist for my thyroid to see if it is cancer. I don't know. I might have to have surgery to remove it, but technically currently I am in remission. But that's the one thing with cancer. You just never know. You might have a bone pain in your leg that you're like, what is this? You know, and of course, as a cancer survivor, your first thought goes to, oh no, I have bone cancer. And I think that's something I'll just face the rest of my life, knowing that I'm always going to have some scares here and there, and, you know, just not trying not to worry about it, but living in the moment, living in the present. Like today I'm healthy. So I'm healthy today. Minus the cold, you can hear in my voice.
Oh, you know, you sound great. You sound great. And obviously we'd love to, you know, to keep up and, you know, let us know how it goes. Let our audience know how things go. So how was your experience? Because obviously everyone has a different experience with healthcare professionals. But for you, how was your experience with the healthcare professionals that you met with on your journey on the way?
So I would say it's like anything in life. You know, you go to the grocery store and sometimes you have like a really ornery person who checks you out. And then other times you have someone who's like, hi, how's your day? And they ask you a million questions. You're like, wow, that person was really friendly. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes, I do.
Okay. I would say it's the same situation with healthcare professionals. There were some doctors who I thought, man, that guy's kind of a jerk. And then there were some that I was like, wow, he is the nicest, kindest man. Made me feel so like validated, answered my questions, made me feel heard, which I think is the most important thing when you're going through cancer or any kind of disease. You want a doctor who's going to hear you, who's going to make you feel like he has compassion and understands you. Mm-hmm. And I would say, continue to go find a doctor who makes you feel that way. And I did just that. I had an amazing oncologist, Dr. Jason Stinnett. He's incredible with Utah cancer specialists. And my doctor up at Huntsman for my double mastectomy and construction, Dr. Agarwal, was incredible. That's not to say I didn't interact with some healthcare professionals who I felt like it was kind of like, yeah, take a number, you know, like I got lots of people with cancer here. But the ones that I dealt with and that I chose to continue to see made me feel like I was their number one patient, that their goals were my goals. And so
that you mattered.
I'd say I had a good experience, but I also had not so great ones along the way. I left one time meeting with a doctor who I was going to have do my double mastectomy. I left in tears from her office because she treated me like I felt like she treated me like I was ignorant, incompetent, didn't understand her. But I mean, I'm a young girl. I hadn't even known really what a double mastectomy was at that age. You know, I was kind of like, I think it means they cut your breasts off, but I have no idea like what that entails. And I remember asking her a lot of questions and her treating me like I was kind of dumb. And I remember like, I just left her office bawling. And I'm like, this is like the biggest thing that's going to happen to me in my life. And you're like acting like it's so insignificant. And so, some healthcare professionals, like I would say, need to work on being a little more compassionate, but I would say there are many out there who are.
Hmm. On that note too, what was your treatment process once you found a professional that, you know, made you feel like you were the only patient in the world? How did that go?
It was great. So I had to do a 4.5 month really strong chemotherapy. It was a dose of Herceptin. I don't know if you care about these drugs, but Herceptin, carboplatin, Taxotere and Perjeta, which are really intense grouping together of chemotherapy. It's pretty much the hardest you can get hit for breast cancer. And every 3 weeks we'd go in, I had a port put in below my clavicle, and we'd go in and take a full day to get all those different drugs pumped into you. Mm-hmm. And then we wouldn't come back for 3 weeks, but for about a week, well, it was 10 days to 14 days after, you were just sicker than a dog. I couldn't eat. I'd lose a lot of weight. Felt the side effects of the chemotherapy for those, like 10 days. And then after about 10 days, you'd start to feel a little bit better. Now, granted, you would never feel 100%, but you'd be like, right, oh, I can eat again. But then by the time you're feeling good again, you'd have to go and get zapped again for your third week. And I had 6 of those big major, chemo days. And then I was on Herceptin, which is not so bad. It's a light dose chemotherapy for a year. Mm-hmm. And then after that, so after chemotherapy, I had a double mastectomy, which they recommend for someone with the BRCA gene. And I had some complications with my implants. Well, they weren't my implants, tissue expanders. So they do the double mastectomy, they remove all the breast tissue, and then they place tissue expanders inside the chest cavity to create new breasts if a woman wants, you know, reconstruction, which, of course, I'm young, I'm single, I gotta have new boobs, right? So my tissue expanders got infected. So I was in the hospital for a few weeks in October because the infection was so bad. I was really sick. Luckily, we were able to save the tissue expanders. We didn't have to remove them. And I was able to carry on with reconstruction. And then they did implants in December. So it was just a long process. You know, I found out I had cancer in April. And I wasn't done with all my treatments until a year later, April of 17.
Now, was there ever a moment where you, of defeat, or where you felt defeated? And if so, how did you push through?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this is like anything in life. You had moments where you're just like, I can't do this. And it was usually during the sick days, you know, the 10 days after your chemo hit. I'd be laying on the couch, nauseous, throwing up, rashes. I'm bald. I don't feel well. I can't eat anything. My mouth tastes like I have a dead rat inside with, you know, metal. It's like the worst taste in your mouth when you're on chemotherapy. Certain chemo drugs, obviously, not every single chemotherapy does the same thing. So there'd be moments where I'd just be like, I can't do this for 4.5 months. There's no way. And then I'd usually call my mom or a sister and I'd cry and I'd be like, I don't feel good. And, you know, that's probably exactly how I sounded. And they'd say, I'm so sorry. I love you. You know, what can I do? And just, you know, letting it out. Mm-hmm. And then you go to bed and you feel a little bit better the next day. Or even if you didn't feel better, just knowing that, okay, I don't feel good today. But I know because last time it took about 10 days to feel better. I'm probably going to feel better in 10 days. And so, yeah, there were definitely moments, but it was the mental self-talk. And I really recommend books, especially if someone's diagnosed with cancer. Anybody could use this in life, though. Books about how to be mentally strong. Because I would say those were the things that really helped me get through this, is mm-hmm. using my mental strength to overcome whatever physical pain I was going through. And not that I'm not saying I'm a mentally strong person. I hope it doesn't sound like I'm saying that, because I think we all have this capacity inside of us to reach down deep and pull on that mental strength. But I feel like a lot of the books I had read and things I'd studied throughout my life had really helped me get to that point where I could be like, okay, I really want to just give up and cry and not go to work for the next month. But I worked throughout my whole thing, but I really feel like it was that reaching deep down and, you know, using that mental strength to get me out of bed when the last thing I wanted to do was even move.
Well, that's rough. Now, when you did talk to your oncologist, what were some key questions that you asked and that you would advise people to ask?
Well, I had gone and done a little bit of research about cancer and people who beat cancer. And there's this guy I'd like to follow on YouTube. His name's Chris Beat Cancer is the YouTube channel. I can't remember his last name. I think it was like Warwick or something. Anyways, he has a whole list of things you should ask your oncologist when you get cancer. And so I remember I looked at that list and asked them a bunch of different things. And one of the main questions I liked was talking about, would you do this treatment yourself? And would you prescribe this treatment to your daughter or your wife or vice versa, someone you love, you know, if it was a woman doctor? You know, because I like knowing that, okay, you would give your wife this treatment. You would give your husband this treatment. Okay. And then also asking lots of questions about side effects, not just right now, but like, what are the side effects 10 years down the road? Like, I mean, I was only 34, so I'm single. I don't have kids. It's like, so is this going to make it so I can't have children? Like, ask questions long-term, anything. Cause I've had friends who went through cancer and like, I'd ask them a question and they didn't know the answer. And I was like, well, why didn't you ask your doctor that? Like, do not feel afraid to ask every single question you have. And don't feel like you're wasting the doctor's time. And if he makes you feel that way, go find another doctor who doesn't. Because your doctor should answer every question you have till you don't have any more questions.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Now, diet-wise, did you alter what food you ate during treatment? And have you continued with food changes afterwards?
Well, I've actually always lived a pretty healthy lifestyle. I don't drink. I've never smoked. I don't drink soda. Pop is what we call it here in Utah. But I don't drink pop. I've never even tasted Coca-Cola. But while I was going through treatments, I really couldn't eat very much for those first 10 days. So I drink a lot of ginger ale, which I know below pop. I never had pop like in my life. And then I start drinking ginger ale and Sprite, but I was so nauseous. Like that's the only thing I could really keep down. It would kind of calm my stomach.
Mm-hmm.
And like maybe crackers, But
ginger ale is magical that way.
I know, isn't it? It was amazing. I was like, man, what is this good stuff? But I would never want to touch it now. It's funny how I'm like, pop just doesn't do it for me. I don't know why. I'd rather probably have a candy bar, but
nothing wrong with that.
Right. So anyhow, during treatment, no. And I know that people do, and maybe you probably should if you go from a natural perspective. I just couldn't. Like, it was hard enough to even get calories in me. I lost like 25 to 30 pounds going through treatment. However, I started studying a lot about like natural health, like natural cures and therapies for post-cancer. I've read a lot of books about that. I really believe in like the benefits of a plant-based diet. Now, I'm not going to sit here because I would totally be a hypocrite if I told you I was perfect at living this. I'm not. I still eat meat, and I'll eat junk food here and there, but I try to keep a very plant-based like diet, but I'm not always successful.
So what helped you most through this journey? I mean, obviously you do the YouTube, you were talking about sharing, but tell us in your own words.
The thing that helped me the most was probably other people, like not being afraid to be open. So I would always, I mean, if anyone out there loves Brené Brown like I do, I mean, she's all about like how openness is really what's going to connect us as human beings. And so I think for me, like the thing that helped me the most was sharing my journey, being open, like being open about the times that were really hard, and then being open about the things that were like kind of embarrassing. Like I have a video on my channel about had diarrhea like 24/7. Like diarrhea is an embarrassing topic. And especially I was dating and I was like, I mean, that's even funnier that I'm on a date and I have a bald head and I'm going through chemotherapy. But you know, it's like something that could be really embarrassing. The fact that I like was going to go to the bathroom in this guy's truck, like turned into a funny story because I was able to be open and vulnerable and share with others something that's going to make them laugh. And in turn, it's going to make me laugh. And as I can recognize like the humor in my situation, it really just helped me get through it all. And having other people cheering me on. And I think when you're going through something hard, whether it be whatever disease you're going through or challenge in life, like the more open you can be about it, you'll find that other people can relate. And it's that connectivity and relatedness that like really brings us all together and helps you get through the hard times, I think.
Yeah, I agree. Now, you obviously mentioned the negatives for some of the doctors. What if you could give the healthcare industry providers and doctors one piece of advice, what would it be?
The one piece of advice I would say is put yourself in the patient's position. You know, these doctors like have studied cancer or they've studied whatever their field or trade is, you know, for years. So for them, it's like common knowledge, but they need to understand that we're the average folk. We don't understand like, and here I had a background in cancer. I mean, my mom's a 2-time cancer survivor. My sisters have cancer. Like I should know a lot about this, but yet there was still so much I didn't know. And so put yourself in my shoes, you know, you don't know everything. And so be a little compassionate, like, take the time to explain things, recognize that they don't know, this is scary for them. And I think a lot of doctors do that. So I want everyone to know, like what I was saying before, like I really think there's amazing doctors out there who really genuinely care about their patients. So, but I would say just continue to do that, you know, recognize that this person is scared to death and that you have the opportunity to help them and comfort them in that their really major time of need.
Well, thank you for sharing that. And thank you so much for talking with us today, Sharee. And from all of us here at Trial Site News, we're rooting for you and your family and are wishing you all the best as everything moves forward. And for those of you in the audience interested in learning more about her and her story, you can check her out on her YouTube channel at Breast Cancer Babe and her Instagram, a page at Sharee Page. And links will be provided in the description below. So Sharee, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
The pleasure was all ours. And for everyone else listening, you can also find us, Trial Site News, on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. The links will be provided in the description below as well. Thanks again for joining us today, and we'll see you all next time.